Welcome to Twin Oaks Presbyterian Church. Almost every Sunday morning I see faces that I don't know. And so if I don't know you and you haven't introduced yourself to me, my name is Russ. I'm the lead pastor here. And almost always after the service of worship, I'm either loitering right down here or back there. Find me, say hello to me, introduce yourself to me. I'd really appreciate the opportunity to meet you and to welcome you. We're here this morning for that great purpose of mankind, to glorify God and to enjoy Him forever. And we will glorify Him with the praises of His people as we worship and sing together. Before we do so, I want to make a couple of announcements, the first of which is to make an apology for my apology last week. Now, for those of you who were here, there was some confusion about what one of the Sunday school classes was going to be like, whether it was going to be online only or there would be a group of people meeting. And evidently, after Sunday, I had a number of people talk to me, and the only person in the church who was confused about how that class was going to work was me. So the bulletin was right, and the people who met downstairs expecting somebody to be there, everybody was right. So here's what's going to happen. I will be teaching through this denominational sexuality report that you'll find written about in your bulletin. There's a group of people, the Sunday school class, will be meeting downstairs and watching that on video, and then one of our elders will be fielding questions and walking through it with you on a week-to-week basis for the next 11 weeks. So I apologize. The Preachers Forum begins tonight at 6:30 downstairs, and what that is we bring in young seminarians from Covenant Theological Seminary and other young pastors, give them the opportunity to preach. It's a short time, a one-hour worship service. We have a call to worship, we sing a song, a man gets up and preaches, and then afterwards, you, the members of the congregation, you give him feedback. You tell him what you understood, what you didn't understand, what made sense, what didn't make sense, the way that he spoke, whether it was clear to you, if it was too loud, if it was too quiet, if he had distracting, bizarre gestures that he doesn't even know that he's doing. You give him feedback, and he learns how to grow as a communicator of God's word with his people, and you participate in training him for the ministry to which God ultimately will send him. And we'll be doing that tonight at 6:30 downstairs. The roads are clear. It's going to be warm. I invite you to come back and to participate in the training of young men to preach God's word. Also, the Golden Oaks have a luncheon this coming Friday. This is the last day to register. If you have any questions, talk to Jim and Barbara Harry right there. They will get you signed up for a luncheon this Friday with the Golden Oaks. We have an inquirer's class this Friday evening and Saturday morning, and so if you want to learn more about our church, what we believe, what we practice, why we do those things, or if you're interested in joining the church, then you can call the office, you can register online for the inquirer's class. Next Sunday after church is a fold luncheon. If you belong to the DeGroat or Marcotte folds, then you will be meeting after the service of worship in the fellowship hall for a luncheon. And if you're a visitor and you want to find a way to get to know new people that's really easy, just show up. You don't have to bring anything. You don't have to sign up. Just show up for a fold lunch and get to know some of the people here at Twin Oaks. This coming summer, we'll have a Mexico mission from May 28th through June 4th. If you're interested in serving on that mission, talk with that man or his wife or Brett Fry, who will be helping to lead the mission and will be sending people to help our missionaries as they labor at the U.S.-Mexico border. Well, you're going to hear more about faith promise over the course of the next hour or more. You get an understanding of what that means, but for the moment, I'd like to invite J.G. Porwall to come speak to us. He's going to give a testimony about the importance of what we're doing here today in committing ourselves through Faith Promise to support our missionaries.
Good morning. I'm not bringing this up because I'm going to talk long, but I always get dry mouth. Okay, first of all, the fact that Jenny and I were recipients of Faith Promise for many years in Russia, I can't say anything before I just say thank you so much for those of you who are involved in Faith Promise giving, budgeting for world missions that way. We are extremely grateful. Churches continue to be supportive of us in a different budgetary process. now that we're back in the States. And so again, thanks so much for your commitment to us and what we do. I hadn't planned to say anything about this until things happened just the other day about the Russia-Ukraine situation, but having lived there 20 years and still in contact with lots of people over on the wrong side of the border, so to speak, in Russia. Any vestiges of democracy that existed at one point are now totally gone. It's obvious that Putin's a dictator. He's unilaterally making decisions, doesn't care what his citizenry thinks. Freedom of speech is gone. Any Russian who shows up in the street or in any way publicly disagrees with the war is being thrown in jail with charges of treason. So freedom of speech is gone in that country. So a madman's on the loose. The Ukraine is the breadbasket and the Bible Belt of the former Soviet Union. Lots of churches, lots of believers. MTW has a team there. So obviously we need to keep praying for the war to end, as well as for believers there in both countries to rely on the truth, to rely on God and His Spirit, and for this to be resolved in the way that the Lord would have. So, what about faith promise today? I actually am prepared not to talk about what's going to happen with faith promise. That's described in here. But Jenny and I are what happened to us with faith promise this past year. A year ago, we got together, said, okay, what are we going to do? And our figures were quite different from one another. And as we talked about it, it became very apparent that, well, Jenny was thinking pretty rightly about the whole thing, and I was really out to lunch. So then let me explain both of those. How was Jenny thinking rightly about it? One, trust God to impress upon you, upon her, upon us, the amount that we could trust Him for. Two, that there would be funds that we don't anticipate coming. We don't see it down the highway. It's not on the horizon, that God is going to provide out of His creative provision. Okay? And so Jenny came up with a figure. And so as we discussed it, and I was trying to defend my side, which wasn't very easy, when I distilled everything down to the core, it was that I was saying, but you know, if the Lord doesn't provide, I better have plan B in place. And so my projected figure was based on my plan B. How do we cut this and that out of the budget on our salary? What can come out of savings, et cetera, et cetera? And I said, JG, come on, you are so out to lunch on this whole thing. So anyway, I confessed all that. And we came back together and talked about and agreed on a figure with these conditions. One, that we and I specifically would pray more about it than I had in the past. Two, okay, even though we still raise support for our stateside crew work, no unexpected gift to our crew account would apply to faith promise. It just wouldn't be considered, okay? So it really needs to be personal funds that were given to us. And then the condition that really set me free, though, was this one. If God doesn't provide, I am not going to embrace feelings of guilt and shame for not fulfilling my faith promise. And that was the key that really set me free. And obviously, it caused me to pray a whole lot more about it as well. Okay, so we go forward a couple months later, out of the blue, totally unexpected, we get some money in the mail. And instantly, Jenny and I say, hey, faith promise. And it was a third of our faith promise amount. So life goes on, we get busy doing our normal thing, and every couple weeks I shoot up a prayer, okay, God, don't forget about this. And then a while later, more money came our way, totally unexpected, which much more, it fulfilled the remaining two-thirds easily, okay? And so when stuff like that happens, when Scripture talks about being a cheerful giver, well, it's pretty easy to be a cheerful giver when God's provision is just so obvious. And so as we go forward, and I think other people will explain exactly how the money is going to be used, and we met the missionaries a couple weeks ago, and how the different places around the world that we're involved as a church. I just encourage you, think like Jenny and not like me a year ago, okay? Ask God to impress upon you what you can trust him for and in ways that you can't anticipate how it's going to be. And obviously, you sure I'd love to say, hey, God provided $100,000 through us for Faith Promise, okay? We're not talking about frivolous stuff, okay? But ask God to, you know, to give you a specific figure, and then just trust him that it's going to take place, and you know, and give it as he provides. A scripture that's really encouraging me in a whole lot of areas, and in this one too, Romans 8:32, he who did not spare his own son, but delivered him up for us all, how will he not also with him freely give us all things? Now, you could say that makes God a cosmic Santa Claus to give us whatever we want, but we know that's not what it means. But he who did not spare his own son, but delivered him up for us all, how will he not also with him freely give us all things we need to fulfill his will in our lives? Of course, that's what it means. And so that involves faith promise, that involves all kinds of stuff, okay? So my prayer would be those who've been involved with Faith Promise, continue, please. Those who haven't yet, I encourage you, dip your toe in the water this year and say, okay, God, what little amount can I trust you for this year? And just see what happens. And may the Lord make it so, and may he continue to accomplish his great commission as he sees fit. Thanks.
Now take a moment to prepare as we step into the worship of our God and prepare yourself to lend your voice to the praise of our Savior.
Our theme verse for this year's Global Missions Conference comes from Matthew 28, those familiar words of Jesus' great commission. It includes the phrase, of all nations. Now, we can put a date on those words around 30 AD. Our call to worship this morning comes from 1 Chronicles 16. It includes the phrase, among the peoples. We can put a date on those events around 1000 BC. So my question to you is, for how long has it been God's plan to call a people to himself from every nation, from every tribe, from every tongue? It goes far beyond even that. Ephesians says, before the foundation of the world, God's plan of redemption was to include people from every nation, tribe, and language. And we are gathered this morning as one particular body of those people to worship God. So will you please stand as God calls us to worship from 1 Chronicles 16. Oh, give thanks to the Lord, call upon his name, make known his deeds among the peoples.
Glory in his holy name. Let the hearts of those who seek the Lord rejoice.
Ascribe to the Lord the glory due his name. Bring an offering and come before him. Worship the Lord in the splendor of his holiness. Do just that as we remain standing and sing, Come People of the Risen King. God and Father, what a joy it is to rejoice, to be here as your gathered people, and to consider the truth of your plan of redemption from eternity past. It's good to give thanks to the Lord, to call upon your name, to make known your deeds among the peoples, for you are calling a people to yourself from every nation, from every tribe, and from every language. And Father, we praise you that you count us among that by the grace of Christ. We pray that this worship service this morning would honor and glorify you who has done so much for us in Christ. And it's in his name we pray. Amen. Please be seated.
In Matthew chapter 10, Jesus instructs his disciples as they go out as missionaries on his behalf to preach the gospel. And as he instructs them, he talks to them about what the consequences will be for those who do not receive him as, or them, as they would receive him. Because if Jesus commissions them and if they go out in his name and they go out as his ambassadors and they go out as in essence, royal representatives of the king, well, then how should you receive them? And so Jesus says to his disciples, and whatever town or village you enter, find out who is worthy in it, and stay there until you depart. As you enter the house, greet it. And if the house is worthy, let your peace come upon it. But if it is not worthy, let your peace return to you. And if anyone will not receive you or listen to your words, shake off the dust from your feet when you leave that house or town. Truly, I say to you, it will be more bearable on the day of judgment for the land of Sodom and Gomorrah than for that town. I think sometimes when I read that, my default assumption is that doesn't necessarily apply to me, but I think it applies to all of us in the sense that, especially as American Christians, we have a tendency to be concerned about America. And we pour a lot of effort into ministry and local missions and caring about our society and our culture, caring about our political system, and pouring interest into those things, while largely neglecting the progress of the gospel around the world. But surely Christ has sent his representatives all over the place. And so this provides us an opportunity to turn away from apathy, to turn away from lack of concern, to turn away from a focus that is almost only and always internal and focused on what the Lord is or is not doing here, to lift our eyes to consider that he has sent his missionaries all around the world and that we're to be concerned for all of them, to support them, to receive them, even as we would receive him, because there is a very real sense in which they are royal representatives of the king. Let's take a moment to turn our hearts toward God in a time of quiet confession. Heavenly Father, we confess that there are times that we forget that the fields are white for harvest, and they're white around the world. Father, will you forgive us our apathy? Will you forgive us the narrowness of our focus? And Father, will you put in our hearts a deep desire to honor those who go out for the sake of the name of Christ, who are his representatives and ambassadors in the world, and will you equip us to receive them and to receive them well and to send them out and to send them out well and to support them in all ways, giving the dignity they so deserve as we seek the good, not only of our own nation, but of the many nations of the earth, not only of our own neighbors near, but our neighbors far, even on the other side of the world. So, Father, forgive us our sin, forgive us our apathy, and put in us a deep and a holy desire to honor Christ by honoring those whom he sends out. And we ask it in Jesus' name. Amen. And Jesus also talks about the reward for those who have supported those whom Jesus sends. He says again in Matthew 10, "Whoever receives you receives me, and whoever receives me receives him who sent me." The one who receives a prophet because he is a prophet will receive a prophet's reward, and the one who receives a righteous person because he is a righteous person, will receive a righteous person's reward. And as we consider what that means, we're going to sing, and part of our singing is a prayer for strength to be about my master's business, even as that business is brought to me by those near and far, even as I participated in it as one who is near or far, no matter the cost or the opposition, we have the responsibility to receive them, even as we receive him, and send them out accordingly. So will you stand with me as we sing together from page 6, Bought by the Blood.
Thank you.
please remain standing as we confess our faith together out of Romans chapter 10. And the simple truth of missions is this: someone must go. And if it is not you that God calls to go, then surely he calls you to support those who go, for they go with beautiful feet, do they not? So let's confess together. For the scripture says, everyone who believes in him will not be put to shame, for there is no distinction between Jew and Greek, for the same Lord is Lord of all, bestowing his riches on all who call on him. How then will they call on him in whom they have not believed? And how are they to hear without someone preaching?
And how are they to preach unless they are sent? As it is written, how beautiful are the feet of those who preach the good news.
And join with me as we sing All Around the World on page 8 in your bulletin.
Seated. Good morning, everyone. Just a quick aside on Faith Promise, JG, I always take Jackie's number. And we were very fortunate this past year to actually, by me taking her number, we God blessed us to triple our faith promise giving for this past year. So I just have learned to just take her number and trust God. As the ushers come forward this morning, if you haven't already, tear the attendance card off to register your attendance as well as to share any prayer requests you may have. Our scripture passage to lead us in corporate prayer this morning is in Acts chapter 1, verse 14. All these with one accord were devoting themselves to prayer. So please pray along with me. Our God and King, we continue in your service and worship this morning in corporate prayer, knowing that your word reminds us that in Psalm 66:18, if we regard iniquity or transgressions and sin in our heart, that you will not hear our prayer. And as part of our worship service, we are reminded to confess sin before a holy and precious God. So we have done that, and we ask that you would hear our prayers. We thank you for the redeeming power of your Son and his guiding presence of the Holy Spirit in our lives daily as we walk this earth, taking care of our families and doing the things that you've charged us to do each and every day. The prophet Isaiah wrote, "Seek the Lord while he may be found, and call upon him while he is near." The psalmist proclaimed, "Therefore, let everyone who is godly offer prayer to you at a time when you may be found. Surely in the rush of great waters, they shall not reach him when that time comes." Dear Lord, we pray for our brothers and sisters and churches in the Ukraine this morning, Lord. God is our refuge and strength, a very present help in trouble. Therefore, we will not fear though the earth gives way, though the mountains be moved into the heart of the sea, though its waters roar and foam, the mountains tremble at its swelling. There's a river whose streams make glad the city of God, the holy habitation of the Most High. God is in the midst of her, and she shall not be moved. God will help her with her mourning and her groans. Though the nations rage and the kingdoms totter, he utters his voice and the earth melts. The Lord of hosts is with us. The God of Jacob is our fortress. Come behold the works of the Lord, how he has brought desolation on the earth. He makes wars to cease to the end of the earth. He breaks the bow and shatters the spear. He burns the chariots with fire. Be still and know that I am God. I will be exalted among the nations. I will be exalted in the earth. The Lord of hosts is with us. The God of Jacob is our fortress. Dear Lord, we ask your blessing and guidance and continued strength on our dear sister, Chris Ferguson, our church member of the day. Thank you for her sweet spirit and her passion for your word and her passion for you. She just desires, Lord, that you would continue to help her to always, each and every day, trust only in you and not herself. Lord, we continue to pray for our loved ones and friends and family that are battling the infirmities of the body, whether it be cancer or other infirmities that have attacked the body. Lord, you have made the body, you've designed it, you know all about it. We pray for their caretakers, for their doctors, for their therapists, for their surgeons, for all who are involved in each and every individual's own personal situation that you truly do know about. Lord, we thank you for our special needs ministry and continue to bless them and give them guidance as only you can. As we prepare to hear what you have prepared in rust to preach to us this morning, Lord, open our hearts, but more importantly, open the Holy Spirit up to us that we will learn and prepare to hear your word. Our stewardship verse this morning, as a reminder, God calls us to stewardship according to Acts 4:32-33. The full number of those who believed were with one heart and soul. No one said that any of the things that belonged to him was his own, but they had everything in common, and with great power were giving their testimony to the resurrection of the Lord Jesus, and great grace was upon them all. And all of God's children said, Amen.
As a father, I am biblically obligated to provide food and shelter and clothing, along with spiritual instruction to my children. I'm obligated to provide those things to them. I am also free to give my children gifts. Not obligated to give them gifts, but free to give them gifts. And so if I wanted to give my soon-to-be 17-year-old daughter a pony for her birthday, I'm free to do so. Now, she probably doesn't want a pony for her birthday, so I'm probably not going to do that. I'm free to do it, probably won't do it. And I also have two dogs that are roughly the size of ponies. So I don't need another pony in the house, but you get the point. I'm free to give her that if I wanted to, and it leads to this. There's a difference between an obligation and a gift. There is a difference, a fundamental difference, between an obligation and a gift. And today, we will open to the book of 3 John, this little book toward the end of the New Testament, to talk about what it looks like for us to be a congregation that supports our missionaries. Now, what that means, among other things, and I'll speak to those of you who are here and also those of you who are joining us via live stream, is that today, yes, we will talk about money. And money gets to be a touchy thing. And so I want you to note this. This is, in many respects, a family conversation. And so if you're brand new to Twin Oaks, or you're visiting for the first time, or you've recently come here, I invite you to listen in. And I invite you to overhear. And I also invite you to have no sense of responsibility for the things that I will say to our family. If you're not a Christian, I invite you to listen in. And I invite you to overhear and listen for a biblical understanding of one way that Christians think about our use of money and generosity and what it looks like to be responsible to support the people whom God sends out. And if you are a member or a regular attender of Twin Oaks, then I want you to consider in your own heart and to think about whether you think about your role in supporting our missionaries as something that you are free to do or as something that you are obligated to do. And open with me to 3 John. 3 John is a little bitty letter. It's in the back of the New Testament. It's on page 1026 in the Black Bible in the pew in front of you. It's written by a man named John. John was one of Jesus' disciples, became an apostle in the early church, and he is writing to one of his friends, a man by the name of Gaius. And as he writes to him, he's talking about supporting missionaries who have come to their respective churches. And as John writes, he teaches that missionaries labor for the name. They go out and they labor for Jesus. And because they do so, you who remain, you must co-labor with them. And so as I read, I want you to listen for how John explains both how they labor and how you must co-labor with them. And as we read together, let's remember that this is God's holy word from 3 John, beginning in verse 5. Beloved, it is a faithful thing you do in all your efforts for these brothers, strangers as they are, who testified to your love before the church. You will do well to send them on their journey in a manner worthy of God, for they have gone out for the sake of the name, accepting nothing from the Gentiles. Therefore, we ought to support people like these, that we may be fellow workers for the truth. The grass withers and the flowers fade, but the word of our God stands forever. So John is talking about missionaries, in this case, missionaries who are traveling through. And I want to ask simply, well, how do these missionaries labor? How do they labor? What is taking place? And what does John say about them that gives you an idea of what they're doing? How do these missionaries labor? And John says two things, the first of which is they go out for the Lord. They actually go out for the Lord. Verse 7 says, they have gone out for the sake of the name. And that phrase, they've gone out, doesn't simply reply or indicate wandering about, so to speak. It means they're purposefully setting out on a mission to accomplish something. And it's a word that John also uses when he talks about false teachers who have purposefully gone out to deceive. So this is a word, they have gone out. They have set their minds to go out. They have set their hearts to the work of the Lord and have gone out. And the missionaries that John describes here propose to go out for the sake of the name, that is, for the name of Jesus. And you know that because you've heard that phrase used previously in the scripture. In Acts chapter 5, Peter and John were arrested for teaching about Jesus, and they were brought before the Jewish leaders in Jerusalem, before a group of men called the Sanhedrin. And after the Sanhedrin had a discussion, Luke records in Acts chapter 5, verses 40 and 41, what they decided to do. And when they, that is the Jewish leaders, had called in the apostles, that is Peter and John, they beat them and charged them not to speak in the name of Jesus and let them go. Then they, that is Peter and John, left the presence of the council, rejoicing that they were counted worthy to suffer dishonor for the name. And these missionaries, they have gone out likewise for the name, on a purposeful mission to tell others about our Savior. And so if we ask the question, how do our missionaries labor? Well, firstly, John says that they go out for the Lord, they go out for the name, they go out for Jesus, but they also go out, secondly, they go out depending on you. Our missionaries go out depending on you. Look again at verse 7. They have gone out for the sake of the name, accepting nothing from the Gentiles. They've accepted nothing from the Gentiles. I think here that receiving nothing from the Gentiles is probably a better translation. They have received nothing from the Gentiles. I mean, after all, Jesus accepted a glass of water when he was weary from the Samaritan woman at the well. It's not like you are prohibited from accepting a gift from a non-believer should they want to offer it to you. And so the gist of the text is not focused on the unwillingness of missionaries to accept help from non-Christians, but often on the unwillingness of non-Christians to render help to Christian missionaries. You see the difference. And so they received nothing from the Gentiles, not here in the sense of Gentiles, in the sense of as opposed to Jews. They're not talking about believing Gentiles who refuse to support a Christian mission. They're using the word Gentiles here in the sense of the heathen, of those who do not know, who do not love, and who do not follow and revere the name. Now, the Bible makes clear, of course, the principle that those who labor in Christian ministry have the right to take their living from their labor in Christian ministry. You know what the Apostle Paul says in 1 Corinthians 9. He asks, "Do you not know that those who are employed in the temple get their food from the temple, and those who serve at the altar share in the sacrificial offerings? In the same way, the Lord commanded that those who proclaim the gospel should get their living by the gospel." A congregation should support its pastors. But the distinction here is that the Bible nowhere expects non-Christians to pay to receive Christian teaching. Nowhere does it expect that a missionary should go out and charge for the gospel. But understanding the context, in the first century at this time, there were traveling missionaries all throughout the Roman Empire, traveling men who were teaching religious or philosophical principles, and almost always they charged for their teachings. They charged to impart knowledge, and in many cases, they enriched themselves at their listeners' expense, withholding something that they painted as good and profitable and true until and unless you paid me for it. Well, this is not how Christians conducted themselves. You know Paul's practice. Paul was an early missionary in the church, and his practice was to charge people nothing. He even tells the believers at Corinth in 2 Corinthians 11 and verse 7, "I preached God's gospel to you free of charge." And these missionaries, whom John mentions, have evidently followed the same pattern, receiving nothing from the non-believers to whom they spoke. But travel was expensive, so how did they afford it? How did they do what they were called to do? Well, churches provided for them. The Apostle Paul talks about this in Philippians chapter 4 when he talks about how it is that he was able to go out and preach to many people without charging a penny to them. And he's talking to the believers at the church at Philippi, and he says this in Philippians 4, 15 through 18, "You Philippians yourselves know that in the beginning of the gospel, when I left Macedonia, no church entered into partnership with me in giving and receiving except you only. Even in Thessalonica, you sent me help for my needs once and again, not that I seek the gift, but I seek the fruit that increases to your credit. I have received full payment and more. I am well supplied, having received from Epaphroditus the gifts you sent, a fragrant offering, a sacrifice acceptable and pleasing to God." And the same is true with missionaries today. They do not charge people, and so when they go out depending on you and me. So how do our missionaries labor? Well, they go out for the Lord. They're very purposeful about it. They're not just wandering about. They're going out for the Lord for the sake of the name, and they go out depending on you. I can only imagine that leaving for the mission field is something like a big trust fall. You've seen this before. Somebody stands up on a chair or whatnot, and then they put their hands like this, and they fall backward, and there's a group of people that's supposed to catch them, right? That's why it's called a trust fall. You have to trust that these people standing there will actually catch you. And I can only imagine that leaving for the mission field must feel something like that. After all, you're leaving your native land. Maybe you're learning a new language. You're selling your home. You're whittling down to your possessions to something only a couple of suitcases can hold. You're dragging kids along and maybe pulling them out of school at an important time in their lives. You're leaving behind aging parents. And maybe more than most, you recognize just how dependent you are on the churches that you are leaving back home, how dependent they must feel on you to remember them and to support them and to make good on the promise that you made when you sent them out. And if then that is how our missionaries labor, going out for the sake of the name and going out in such a posture of needing to trust that they can count on you, depending upon you, then how must you co-labor with them? What does that look like? What does John say about the responsibility of the local church in missions to co-labor with our missionaries? Well, he says a couple of things, and the first thing he says is this, that you should strive to send them out bragging about you. Send them out bragging about you. And I want you to look with me at verse 6. These missionaries testified to your love before the church. They testified to your love before the church. So John, who is likely writing from a church in the city of Ephesus, is writing to his friend Gaius, likely in a completely different city. And John says that there are missionaries who recently came to his church in Ephesus, but before they came to his church in Ephesus, at some point in the past, they visited Gaius's church in a different city, and they came to John's church and bragged about how much Gaius's church had loved them. Now, what kind of love must John be referring to here? It wasn't comprised merely of warm fuzzies, but of physical, tangible provision of housing and food and money so that they could continue to go out for the sake of the name. Gaius' church financially supported missionaries who then went to John's church and bragged about how wonderful Gaius's church was and how they had been supported. Now, how cool is that? And so, just ponder this for a minute. Do we, as a congregation, give our missionaries cause to brag about our love for them? Do we give them cause to brag? Hold that thought. How must you co-labor with our missionaries? Well, firstly, by sending them out bragging on you, and secondly, by sending them out worthy of the Lord. Send them out in a manner that is worthy of the Lord whom they serve. And so verse 5 says, it is a faithful thing you do in all your efforts for these brothers, strangers as they are. These missionaries go out and they serve the name, and John says that supporting them, Gaius' church's support of them, was a quote-unquote faithful thing. It's a faithful thing you do. It's a practical outworking of your faith. It's a practical outworking of your beliefs, and it speaks to the outward manifestation of integrity between what you say you believe and what you actually do, that those things are the same in your life and in mine. And so John commends that continued practice in verse 6 when he says, you will do well to send them on their journey in a manner worthy of God. Worthy of God, what does that mean? Well, they go out for the sake of the name. They go out for the glory of Christ. They go out as his representatives. They go out as ambassadors for the king. This is how Paul described himself in his own missionary labor in 2 Corinthians 5 and verse 20. He said, we are ambassadors for Christ, God making his appeal through us. And so I want you to know that your missionaries, in a very tangible way, represent Christ himself. They appeal on his behalf to the lost to be reconciled to God. And so sending them out in a manner that is worthy of him must mean that you treat them as representatives of the king. You treat them as royal dignitaries. You treat them as important people because you believe they are. And your treatment of Christ's ambassadors says something about your respect and love for Christ himself. And beloved, I know you love him. I know you love him. I know you love the Lord. Therefore, send them out worthy, because to send them out in a manner that is worthy means to send them out as royal representatives with an attitude in your own heart that strives to honor Jesus by honoring those whom he sends out. And therefore, verse 8 says that we ought to support people like these, that we may be fellow workers for the truth. That phrase, fellow workers, is literally co-laborers. You co-labor with your missionaries when you send them out. God takes your financial support and he uses it for them to go out and to tell everybody about Jesus, and God counts you as a co-laborer as though you were going out yourself when you support them. You are a co-laborer with your missionaries, but I want you to understand that you're also a co-laborer with the Lord. This is what Paul teaches in 2 Corinthians 6 and verse 1. He's talking about God's work, and he's talking about his own work as a missionary. And he says, working together with him. Working together with him. Literally, co-laboring together with God. Co-laboring together with God, we. Isn't that amazing? Co-laboring together with God, we appeal to you not to receive the grace of God in vain. See, you not only co-labor with your missionaries, you co-labor with your Lord. Because the gospel is his good word to the lost and the dying. The cross is his good gift to those who are enslaved in sin. Jesus is his great gift to the world. He is the author of salvation. And so when you co-labor with your missionaries, you're not just working alongside them. You're not just coming alongside them. You are co-laboring with God himself in his great work to seek and save the lost. And what a labor that is. What a gift to be involved in that. And so John says, therefore, we ought to support people like these. To support means to take up, like to take up or take in a person as an honored guest, to provide for them as though you count yourself honored to be to have the privilege of supporting them. It would be like if Charles Swindoll or Tim Keller or Alistair Begg or some other hotshot came through town and they wanted to stay at your house. And you would be honored to have them as your guest. But the thing about this that is so profound is something small that we can pass by in verse 5. As John says, "Beloved, it's a faithful thing you do in all your efforts for these brothers, strangers as they are." These were but strangers. Brothers in Christ, yes. Sisters in Christ, yes. But strangers and personally unknown to John, and likely personally unknown to Gaius as well. And if then we owe this level of tangible support, this level of respect, this treatment as royal representatives to Christian strangers, how much more do we owe to our own missionaries whom we know and love and whom we have sent out? Verse 8 therefore says, we ought to support people like these. It's a verb that is used in a generic sense to mean must. And I want you to take it that way, because when we use the word ought, we use it sometimes in a different way. I ought to have stopped at the store and gotten milk on the way home. I ought to have cleaned the garage on Saturday, but instead I sat and watched college basketball. This is how we use the word ought. We use it to speak about an unfulfilled obligation. But a better translation would be must, and an even more specific translation would be the way I think this word is used. It has a specific use when a transaction is in view. And it means to be under obligation to make a payment to one who has previously given to you something of value. To be under obligation to make a payment to one who previously has given to you something of value. Your missionaries give to you something of eternal value. They give to you the opportunity to co-labor with them for the truth. What greater gift? And you are not merely free to support them. You are obligated. How must you co-labor with our missionaries? Well, send them out bragging on you, and send them out worthy of the Lord. Imagine again that moment where a trust fall is taking place, and you're one of the people standing down here catching a person, and the person stands and they begin to fall backward. Are you merely free to catch them? Or is there not a sense in which you are obligated to catch them? I'm obligated to support our missionaries. You are obligated to support our missionaries. We are obligated to support our missionaries. In this congregation, for our foreign missionaries, we do that through faith promise. And you heard a little bit about that this morning. And basically what it means is this. We ask you to pray. We ask you to pray about a number, what you will give, what you ask God to provide to you to give to support our missionaries. And then you fill out a pledge card. JG held one up. They're in the pews. They're in the narthex. You can also fill out a form online. You can fill out a form on the app. We have a Twin Oaks app. However you want to fill it out, and you make a pledge. And then based on those pledges, we make a budget for how we can support our missionaries for the next year. You can give a one-time gift. You can give a little bit every week. You can give a little bit every month. You can wait until this time next year and give it all. How you give, that's completely up to you. What you pledge is between you and God. I won't know. I never see it. The elders don't know. The ministry staff doesn't know. Nobody knows. We don't post anything. Nobody knows what you give, and nobody will call you, and nobody will follow up with you, and nobody will put the thumb screws to you and say, you pledge this, and none of that. This is between you and God. You determine what you will give, and then it's up to you to give what God gives you to give. But it would lead me to say this, and I'm going to say this multiple times. I know it's a violation of English grammar, Don't give nothing. Don't give nothing. I want you to give for two particular reasons. One is for our missionaries' sake. They depend on you. They depend on us. And I would understand if they weren't faithful to Jesus. I would understand if they were peddling a false gospel. That would be one thing. But if they're true to the name of Christ Jesus, then they are worthy of your support because they are His royal representatives. They represent the King. They are ambassadors for your Savior in the world. But secondly, I want you to give for your own growth in faith. And I want you to hear me out. I know it's easy for a pastor to say, I want you to give to church stuff and it'll bless you because you'll grow in faith. But I really do want you to grow in faith. And I think that there are primarily three reasons why people don't participate in something like Faith Promise. And the first is, there is a part of you, and it might be a part of you that you don't like. And it might be a part of you that you need to examine, that loves money more than you love missionaries. Paul warned Timothy of this tendency in the human heart in 1 Timothy 6 and verse 10 when he said, the love of money is a root of all kinds of evil. He didn't say money is the root of all evil. That's not what he said. He said, for the love of money is a root of all kinds of evil. And then he said this, it is through this craving that some have wandered from the faith and have pierced themselves with many pangs. I don't want to see you pierced with many pangs. And so even if it's difficult work to examine your own heart and your own conscience and say, do I have an unhealthy relationship with money such that I care about it more than people? I would exhort you to have that conversation with your heart. I think others of you maybe are more like me. You don't give because you're afraid. You're just afraid. If you give too much, you won't have enough. And one of the things I've had to learn over the years, and I'm still learning it every day, is that you cannot learn to trust your Heavenly Father except by obeying your Heavenly Father. And I want to remind you that He is trustworthy. You know what Proverbs 3 says, trust in the Lord with all your heart and lean not on your own understanding. And a human understanding would say, well, I only have X amount of dollars, and so what am I supposed to do? But Faith Promise is about asking God to give you more than you possess, to give you faith to believe that He'll give it to you. And of course, 2 Corinthians 5, 7 says that we walk by faith, not by sight. So I would say again, don't give nothing. In most years, about 50% of the congregation gives to Faith Promise, but 100% of us are obligated to support our missionaries. Can we push the needle on that number this year? More than 50%. I think thirdly, sometimes people don't give because they're embarrassed, because you have a limited amount to give, or because you're afraid that you'll write a smaller number on that pledge form than someone somewhere expects you to write. But I would give you two answers to that. One is biblical counsel. Listen to what Jesus says in Mark chapter 12. Jesus sat down opposite the treasury and watched the people putting money into the offering box. Many rich people put in large sums. And a poor widow came and put in two small copper coins, which make a penny. And he called his disciples to him and said to them, truly I say to you, this poor widow has put in more than all those who are contributing to the offering box, for they all contributed out of their abundance, but she, out of her poverty, has put in everything she had, all she had to live on. And I want to remind you that the dollar value of your contribution can be $10 or it can be $10,000. Both are pleasing, delightful in the eyes of your Heavenly Father as you determine in your heart that you will with joy support those whom He has called to labor in missions. And I would ask you, is God impressed with human riches? Does God not already own all things? And does He not already completely and eternally love you everlastingly in Christ? And will your contribution or lack thereof make any difference to His love for you and your acceptance before the throne of your Heavenly Father? None. So, don't give nothing. No matter how small, your gift is big. But secondly, I would say this, because nobody will see what you give. We have one person in the business office who will see what you give. Nobody else will see it. Nobody will be judging the size of your contribution. No contribution is too small to those who depend on you. I remember one time being young and poor and in seminary and needing $5 for something. I don't remember what it was, but I do remember I didn't have $5. Payday was the next day. I had like $2.12 in my account. And I remember, you know, rummaging through drawers and looking under cushions in the apartment, trying to find spare change to see if I could piece together $5. And I go to say that, I say that for this reason, because it was a valuable lesson to me. $5 is not a lot of money until you do not have $5. And then it doesn't matter if it's $5 or $55,000. If you don't have it, you don't have it. Now, you may think $5 is small until you're in a foreign land and you don't have it. There is no gift that you could give that would be too small. There is no gift that you can give that is not big in the eyes of your God and in the eyes of the missionaries whom you serve. So, don't give nothing. Support these missionaries for Christ and for His glory. Send them in order to participate in their ministry and in this church as co-laborers. Send them as an act of love for the lost. Send them because you want them to go out as befits ambassadors for your Savior, as royal representatives of the King. Now, I have to tell you, I am not a prosperity gospel preacher, and your God is not a slot machine, and so I will not stand here today and lie to you. I will not promise you that God will repay you penny for penny what you give. I will not promise you that if you give generously, your God will make you rich in this life on this earth. That is a lie, and I simply won't tell it to you, but I will tell you. I will tell you what the Apostle Paul told to the believers at Philippi. I already read part of it this morning, how he talked about being well supplied, how he talked about that church entered into partnership with him over and over again, how he talked about that church sending him out like royalty and equipping him to do what God called him to do, but I didn't read all of it. So let me just pick up again in Philippians 4, verse 18. Paul said, again, I've already read this, I have received full payment and more, I am well supplied, having received from Epaphroditus the gifts you sent, a fragrant offering, a sacrifice acceptable and pleasing to God. But then I left off this last verse, the very next words that Paul says. He says, and my God will supply every need of yours according to His riches in glory in Christ Jesus. And people will take that and they will twist it and make it a promise of material wealth in this earthly life, but it is not that, but rather it teaches this. The glory that is yours in Christ Jesus, the glory that you will step into when this life is done, the glory that you will possess in Christ for all eternity will more than repay you for any loss that you ever suffer here, because you are heirs, co-heirs, along with the King, sons and daughters of your heavenly Father, and you will inherit all that your Father possesses, and your Father possesses all. It will all be yours for all eternity, so fear not giving away small things now. But instead, send them out bragging about Twin Oaks, worthy of the Savior both you and they serve. Providing my children with food and shelter and clothing is an obligation that I bear as their father. I am free to give them gifts, but I am obligated to give them food. Let's not confuse a gift with an obligation, but strive to supply the needs of our missionaries as we ought. For they go out for the sake of the name. They depend on you. This is how they labor. And you, therefore, send them out bragging about our church in a manner that is worthy of ambassadors of the King. For this is how you can co-labor with them and with your God. Will you pray with me? Our gracious God and Father, we thank you for the Lord Jesus Christ, who has sought and saved us, who continues to send out missionaries to seek and save the lost, who has made us co-heirs and so inheritors of all that you possess. So, Father, help us to be faithful and to step out in faith and to trust you to provide so that we can turn around and take what you've given and give it to our missionaries, fulfilling that obligation that is ours to send them out bragging about us and to send them out in a way that is worthy of those who are royal representatives of King Jesus. And it is in his name we pray. Amen. At this point, before we close in song, I would like to invite Mrs. Crystal Barnes to come and speak to us. She is our Director of Missions, and she's going to talk with you briefly about Faith Promise and what your Faith Promise pledges will go to support.
Thank you. I am just here to reiterate the details. A lot has already been said, and there's a lot in your bulletin and in the conference brochure about Faith Promise. But the Faith Promise goal for the July 22 to June 23 global missions budget is $355,000. This goal would provide continued support for our 22 missionaries and one agency, along with the sending of our two Twin Oaks families that are itinerating right now, and for any urgent needs or special projects that our supported missionaries may present to us throughout the year. While you can give, like Russ said, at any point during the physical year, we accept Faith Promise pledges just through March 27th. And this is because our budget is completely based on the pledge amount. It is completely separate from the church regular budget. So you, like also was already said, your pledge is completely confidential. I don't see it, the missions committee doesn't see it, and you don't get reminders throughout the year of, oh, you've only given this amount. It is between you and the Lord. So it is a gift, it is a joy, and it is a blessing to be more deeply involved in kingdom work through the privilege of giving. So if you need more time to talk to the Lord and ask him how much he wants you to give, I encourage you to pick up one of these Faith Promise devotionals. There's some in the narthex. There's also some in the missions windows right behind me. You may make your Faith Promise pledge by filling out one of the pledge cards that you can find in the pew, or as we've said, there are pledge cards online. You can access that through the QR code in the bulletin, also through the church's app under the upcoming events tab. And it's also just on the missions page of the website. So the ushers will be available at the end of the service to collect your physical pledge cards, and in the next month you can also just submit them through the offering plate. Thank you for participating and for praying for the provision of our missionaries.
And so now will you stand with me as we together lift high the name of Jesus? It's on page 10 in your bulletin. And now, beloved, depart with the Lord's blessing. Depart, making it your ambition to send out our missionaries bragging about you and in a manner that is worthy of the royal representatives that they are. And go with God's blessing. May the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord make his grace to shine upon you and be gracious to you. And may the Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you peace. Amen.